Hi everyone, so today it's 10 things about unfamiliar texts that I have come to realise over the years, so let's get started. So because I know I'm going to forget half these things, I'm actually going to refer to my blog post, which you can read, and I'll attach the link below. So unfamiliar texts, number one, students need to realise that they can write a lot of stuff about one little thing. And so for my seniors, for close reading, I use the acronym FIT RACES. Now, this is not something to structure their writing as a whole. This is just so that they can realise that they can actually write a lot about one little thing, even one little word. So FIT RACES, students think about what they feel, they infer, they think about the tone, they relate, so link it to something like another text or a human behaviour or a historical event. They ask a question about it, they connect it with something else from the text, they talk about their experience, so think about the senses, they reason with it, agree, disagree, and so on, and then they sync it back to the question. So that's FIT RACES. For years 10 and 11, I was thinking yesterday about this and I've come up with FETU. Now, FETU stands for what they feel, what they experience, what they think of or think about, and what they understand about this example from the text. And the cool thing for New Zealand teachers, of course, is that FETU, F-E-T-U, in Te Reo Māori, W-H-E-T-U, means star. So FETU, to be a FETU, that is a quite nice little saying, I think. Now, of course, I wouldn't expect students to find something for every one of those letters in the acronyms, but it's a good way to get them brainstorming ideas. Number two, get students to find an example. So often students think they have to find a language technique or a structural technique, one they can name. Just tell them they need to find an example. So stuff from the text that stands out. If they are looking for a technique, they're really limited because often they don't know the names of a lot of techniques, and often the text doesn't rely on specific nameable techniques. So get them to find examples that stand out to them that help them answer the question. Number three, glossaries. We often give students glossaries that obviously are alphabeticized, as every good glossary should be. However, so this is of language and structural terms. However, that's really confusing for students because they can't group the ideas. So if you give them groups of like figurative language techniques, simile, metaphor, personification, hyperbole, blah, 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 or sound and sound devices, and things to do with vocabulary and so on, then those groups make sense to them. So when you say to them, hey, let's look out for some figurative language here, they'll either know, or they can look at their little piece of paper with that group and then go, oh yeah, that's those things. But an alphabeticized list is just random. So you can do it yourself, or maybe it's a cool activity for students to do. Right, are we up to number four? I think so. Rote learning, for goodness sake, there is a place for rote learning. I don't care what all the new age people say. I think rote learning is a really good way to learn those techniques, and they kind of have to be done. How else do we learn our times tables? So two things that I think work really well, and that's the attainment goal test, those little cheat tests that I talked about last time that I'm going to blog about. I'll link below anyway, so that you just give them the answers and they rote learn them, and then they regurgitate. So it's rote learning at its finest. And the other one, of course, is flashcards, where they can test themselves and each other. And another age-old technique that we seem to have forgotten. Number five, answering the question. We're so caught up on getting students to use things like Peltexi, and students are so hung up on using Peltexi to structure their whole answer that they forget to answer the question. because they just write about the text and they're so proud of themselves because, look, I use Paltese and it's well done. However, he didn't answer the question. Not achieved. Number seven. How did I get to number? Where's number six? Okay. I've sorted out my numbers. Number six. And I'm getting controversial now. I don't like the way we encourage students to begin with the purpose first. And I'm actually going to read this bit from my blog because otherwise I get my words muddled. Okay, so it's not logical when to work this out, as in the purpose of the text. A reader must analyse the language and structure of the text first. Our brains load stylistic features on autopilot, processing meanings and effects inherently, like our okay, I sorted out my numbers. Number six, and I'm getting controversial with this one. I don't like the way we ask students to begin with the purpose when they're writing about the text. And here's why. And I'm going to have to put my glasses on because I'm going to read a bit of this from my blog. Okay, it's not logical when to work this out, the purpose out. A reader must analyse the language and structure of the text first, right? So our brains load the stylistic features just on autopilot, processing meanings and effects inherently. Some students can do that. Many students cannot. Beginning with purpose doesn't honour a logical reading sequence. And then the writing is staged, and then they're not really thinking about that reading because they're so hung up on this acronym. Acronyms have their place, as I said at the beginning, but this one just, it's so formulaic that I think it stilts their writing sometimes. I see the benefit of it, but hear me out. So instead, let students' understanding of purpose and idea form organically as they discuss specific examples they picked out from the text. Their deductions should fall from their identification of the meanings and effects of those examples. So they should fall from them naturally. In this way, their writing as a whole is peppered with purpose. I quite like that saying, peppered with purpose. In a more natural manner, the writing makes more sense because the thinking has occurred in a logical, natural sequence. So that's just a little controversial thing that I'm slotting on here. Maybe something for us to think about. As I say, I appreciate the acronyms providing a scaffold for students, but I think we can do that better. Number seven, watch out for students cutting corners in their mad scramble to mention purpose. So one of the things that I notice they do is they mention an example or a feature, And then they bolt straight to talking about how it serves the purpose. So, and that's it. So, for example, this metaphor shows how much the man loves the mountains. But they don't unpack it. They don't talk about the meaning and the effect first. So they're just, oh my God, I've got to mention purpose. And so they go straight to it. The other thing that they do is when they're trying to talk about how features work together, they cut straight to purpose. Again, not unpacking the relationship between those two features first. So they'll say, the metaphor and the connotations of this word work really well together to serve it, to help us understand how much the man loves the mountains. How they haven't unpacked those things first, so just be aware of that. Number eight, getting political again. We are asking students to prove their understanding of content and stylistic features in a really dumb way. They have to write about it. Now, I spent a few years in Abu Dhabi, and when I came back, attunement standards had been born, and I fancied myself as a pretty good reader. I was an English teacher. I did not understand how to answer those unfamiliar text questions because I didn't understand how to write for them, and I actually had to get other teachers to teach me what was expected. So it came down to writing skills. Why can't we be teaching unfamiliar text, or why can't we be assessing what students are able to do with their reading with short answer texts? It makes me think about listening tests. So I remember years ago I decided I'm going to sit a pat listening test. One lunchtime, admittedly mucking around in my room at the same time, and it was a memory test. I was listening out for the key ideas, the key points and so on, and then they say, so what colour was the man's shirt? I don't know. I wasn't listening out for what colour the man's shirt was, and it was irrelevant. It was just a memory test, and I think with this unfamiliar text, it's just a writing test as much as a reading test. We could get students to show their understanding with the good old on between beyond behind the lines questions, short answer questions, and show really high level thinking with some short answers. So that's my little political spiel for today, getting them to write a short little structured essay is about teaching writing. And I think that's why students often struggle with unfamiliar texts, because they're having to learn reading skills and writing skills at the same time, and they're quite different kinds of skills. So it just doesn't make logical sense. So that's my political push for the day. Number nine, practice unfamiliar texts with every text. I'm going to whip up a bit of a template or a guide so that you can do that, and when that's finished I'll link it below. It might be in my freebies thing, or it might be in my store, I'm not sure. So number nine, practice unfamiliar texts with every text that you read. So you're studying your novel. Take an excerpt out and use it as an unfamiliar text, please. Studying a short story, unfamiliar text. Studying a newspaper article, unfamiliar text. You can be doing that all the time. I'm going to do up a bit of a template or a guide soon, and so that it will help you do that. And the other thing is, you should write too. Now that's an age-old strategy, but you can write typing up so it shows on your big screen so that students can see you going back and forth, editing, you know, crossing out, da la la, and that it doesn't just come. It's actually something you think through. Okay, so I lied. There's an 11 and 12. Number 11 is, at the risk of stating the obvious, students have to get used to annotating. They need to practice that skill all the time, and they need to do it on paper. Get them off the devices, blow your printing budget, and get them annotating. And model it yourself first as well. And the other thing is, make it a race. So I've talked about this before, and that's why the Daily Dash works so well, because if students are given an infinite amount of time to write about something, they will sit there with that blank piece of paper in front of them wondering what to do. If you say, right, you've got 10 minutes, let's go, let's see who can get half a page, and here's some chocolates for those who do, whatever, they will just write, and that free thinking works so much better. So there you go, there's 12 little things about unfamiliar texts that I have noticed.